worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise.
Quiet, we'll shout out your praise. Oh.
that there's victory in Jesus this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
You never stop working, even when I don't feel it.
that you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Oh, he's your waymaker this morning. He's a miracle worker. But you know, if that miracle didn't happen, he prayed out of faith that God would move. It didn't happen the way he might have prayed for it, but God moved in his prayers. And that's the kind of God I serve. I serve a God that is faithful through every circumstance, every situation. He's a faithful God that even when I don't feel it, he's still moving. When I don't see it, he's still moving. He is my way maker. Yeah. Situation, but you do, so believe it in faith. Stand out in faith that God's gonna move. Yeah.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yes! Do you believe he's a miracle worker today? I said, do you believe he's a way maker today? Do you think he's a promise keeper today? Oh, hallelujah. Even when you don't see it, he's still moving. Even when you don't feel it, God's still up to something. Amen. Come on, I wish somebody would just take a few moments and give him some praise and lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Doesn't matter what you're going through, God can make a way. Doesn't matter how hard it seems. No matter how dark it looks, God can always make a way because he is the way maker. One more time, give him some praise today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. You can be seated if you'd like, and the kids can go ahead and go to class. I've got instructions here. Hang on to where they're going. I gotta find it. I'll just walk around in circles, I guess, until I find it. Okay. So the kids are the teens and preteens. Oh, wait a minute. That's not right. Hang on. Before everybody leaves, don't leave. We've got a special announcement I want to tell the kids. I forgot about this. Wednesday night, we're having something special for the kids here at church. So come 7 o'clock Wednesday night for the kids. We're going to have cotton candy and snow cones and water games if the weather's permitting, and it's going to be good. It's one last hurrah, I guess, before summer. So parents, make sure you bring your kids. Kids, make sure you tell your parents to make sure that they come on Wednesday night. Then next Wednesday, September the 4th, the teens and the young adults are going to Pizza Town at 7 o'clock instead of coming to church. So let Jamie or Abby Miller know if you need a ride or if you can go or you want to go or whatever. So remember that. All right. And then I think the kids, I'm not sure where they're going. They're going upstairs. They're going out in the fellowship hall. Teens and preteens in the fellowship hall. Primary upstairs. Oh, yeah, it says it right there. So help if I'd read, don't it? All right, I got excited. Sorry. All right, if you want to turn your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 64. Isaiah chapter 64. I hear the kids are moving, so that's a good sign. Isaiah 64, I just want to read one verse. It's verse 4. Isaiah 64, verse 4 says, "For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you, who acts for the one who waits for him." Let me read that again. "For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you, who acts for the one who waits for him." I want to talk to you for just a moment on this topic. You ain't seen nothing yet. And I know that's probably not good grammar, but that's the way I talk. Because I'm from Honaker, and that's okay. You ain't seen nothing yet. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful, Lord, for this day you've given us, this wonderful opportunity, Lord. We got to be in your house to praise your name. And Lord, I'm thankful for your spirit that we've already felt here today, Lord. And God, I pray now as I preach, you anoint me, not just me, but those that are here, Lord, you touch them with your word, Lord, that we could be changed because we've been in your presence and we've felt your touch. Move in our midst today, Lord, and we give you praise. We give you honor. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Won't you turn around and wave at a few people? Greet them. Tell them you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord today. Amen. How many knows that we serve an awesome God? You would agree with that. Amen. We do serve an awesome God. He's a God who moves in the miraculous. He works in the wondrous. He supplies in the supernatural. He answers in the astonishing, and he interacts in the incredible. He is an awesome God. And as Isaiah says here in the scripture that we read, no God has done what our God has done. No human has ever witnessed such a manifestation as what our God has done. No other God can do what our God can do. The scripture says that men haven't heard. So you've never heard tell of miracles for what our God can do. Amen? It says that ears haven't perceived. No one's ever spoken of the miraculous and the marvelous and the phenomenal things such as our God has achieved. Eyes haven't seen, the scripture says. You've never seen anything like what our God can do, because no one can deliver like our God can deliver. No one can heal like our God can heal. No one can provide like our God can provide. No one can restore or renew or reestablish or revive. No one can save like our God can save. His word is full of miraculous things that he's done. His word is full of witness after witness of the miraculous things that our God has done. You just start at the beginning in Genesis 1:1 when it says God created all things, and you read all the way through to Revelation, you'll see miraculous things that he's done. You'll read of his glorious acts. No one has created. No one has parted seas. No one has knocked down walls or killed giants or shut lions' mouths or walked through the fire like our God has done. No one has opened blinded eyes. No one has healed lepers or the lame or the lonely. No one has fed multitudes or walked on water or calmed storms. No one has cast out devils or raised the dead. No one has died on the cross and on the third day rose again and is alive forevermore like our God has done. Amen. But it's not just in this book that we witness God's wonderful, miraculous things. It's not just here that we read about it. But if you look in your own life, you can testify and be a witness of God's miraculous acts that he's done. God has created within your own life. God has parted seas within your own life. God has slayed giants just for you in your life. He's tore down walls in your life. He's moved mountains for you. He's walked through the fire with you. He has brought you back to life because you who were once dead in sins and trespasses has God quickened and brought you back to life. Aren't you glad that once you were dead, but now you're alive? Nobody has done what our God has done. You're a witness. You're a testimony. You're evidence to the miraculous workings of our God has done great things. I wish somebody would give him some praise today for his miraculous and supernatural things that he's done. Aren't you glad you serve a God that's alive and that's well and that moves? But here's the thing. I believe that although we have witnessed miracles at the hands of our God, although we've experienced wonders, although we have seen the spectacular, we ain't seen nothing yet. Because I believe the best is yet to come. But if we're going to see God do something greater, if we're going to see God do something more than what he's already done, there must be a few things that we have to do. And the first thing I want to look at that we have to do is our worship should celebrate his presence. Our worship should celebrate his presence. I think of a story in 2 Samuel chapter 6. Let me kind of set the scene as to what's going on here. The Ark of the Covenant, which represents the presence of God, it was a symbol of the presence and the glory of God. This Ark of the Covenant had been taken. It had been lost. It had been forgotten for some 70 years. It had been kept in the house of a man by the name of Abinadab. And David, King David, the giant slayer, who God had anointed to become king and chose him above everybody else, although no one thought that he should be chosen. As a matter of fact, he didn't even get invited to the party when they were choosing kings. You know, Jesse had all of his sons there and David wasn't even invited. They had to go out to the field where he was with the sheep and bring him in. And Samuel says, oh yeah, he's the guy. So God chose him to be king. That David said that it was his desire, he sought to restore the ark back to the city of Jerusalem so that all Israel could worship God in one place and in one accord. Long story short, it took a while. And so now the Ark of the Covenant is finally coming back to Jerusalem. And the Bible says that when David, this is in 2 Samuel chapter number 6, verse 16, when David saw the ark coming into the city, as he seen it coming down the road, the Bible says he began to dance and leap before the Lord. He began to just worship the Lord. He took off his outer garment and he just began to dance to the Lord. Now, his wife, her name was Michael. She was up in the window, and she looked down and saw him. And the Bible says that she despised him in her heart when she saw him dancing. Well, what happens is the ceremony's over. He goes home, and this is what the Bible says in verse number 20 of 2 Samuel chapter 6. Then David returned to bless his household. And Michael, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, and this is how I think she said it, okay? How glorious was the King of Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids of the servant, as one of the worthless fellows shamelessly uncovered himself. I can just hear the sarcasm as she's telling him to do it. How dare you do what you did? How you embarrass yourself. And this is what David said to her. It was before the Lord, he said, the one who chose me before my father and before all of his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore, I play before the Lord, and I will yet be more contemptible than this, and am willing to be base in my own sight, and of the handmaidens who has spoken of them shall I had be in honor. This is what he's basically saying. You think that was bad, honey? You ain't seen nothing yet. I'm really going to praise the Lord. I don't care to let my guard down. I don't care what people think. I'm going to worship the Lord despite of what people think. Doesn't matter what you think. It doesn't matter what the handmaids think. Doesn't matter what the army thinks. Doesn't matter what the council thinks. God has chosen me. He's done good things in my life. Why would I not want to worship the Lord? Our worship should celebrate his presence. The presence of God, as they saw it, as the Ark of the Covenant was coming into Jerusalem, and David celebrated that by worshiping God. Why did David dance? Because he was celebrating the presence of God. Now, you can dance on Sunday morning if you want. It doesn't bother me. Just don't step on my toes. And I got a saying, you step on my toes, wait till I start preaching, because I'll step on yours. That's okay. But I think our worship should celebrate his presence. See, because it really is all about the presence of God. It really is about us getting into the presence of God. And we have songs to assist us to do that. I think our worship team is top notch. I think they're A+. You can't get no better. They sing good songs. They sing wonderful songs. They practice. They're tight. They're good. The harmony's good. They got talent. They sang my favorite song this morning, Victory in Jesus. I mean, you can't beat that, right? And so they just do a wonderful job. So we have songs to assist. We got leaders, you know, who will lead us into worship. Kim does a wonderful job of leading us into worship. She opens the door, if you will, and she walks through into worship. And she wants you to follow in behind. But here's what I found out about Kim. I'm going to brag on her a little bit. She didn't know I was going to do this. She's going to worship whether you worship or not. She's going to praise God whether you follow or not. She's going to lead whether you follow or not. We've got a wonderful opportunity every Sunday morning to worship the God. We got songs to assist. We got musicians. We've got singers. We've got leaders who will lead us into worship. I get up sometimes and I even give you instructions on how to worship. Raise your hands. Lift your voice. Clap your hands. Somebody give the Lord some praise. It's like you got to poke them sometimes, you know. And prod them along. Come on now, let's get them. You got to pump them and prime them sometimes. And then you have some folks that just sit with their arms crossed, like, move me if you can. You know, now all you people with your arms crossed, I see what you do. You went like this. He ain't talking about me. He ain't talking about me. But I know how it is. And you stand. Some people stand and they just stand in silence. I guess you're singing in your head. I don't know. But let me tell you, there's nothing wrong with singing. I can't sing a lick. Poor Lonzo has to listen to me sing on Sunday mornings. I'm standing right beside him. I'm just bellowing it out, you know. There's a loud victory in Jesus, you know. I almost preach it instead of singing it. But It's okay to sing. It's okay to express your celebration for the Lord. It's okay to worship Him. But sometimes we've got to get back to what I call the heart of worship. Do you remember that song, The Heart of Worship? I looked that up. Did you know that song is like 25 years old? It doesn't seem like it's that long. I've got the words here. This is what it says. When the music fades and all is stripped away and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, something that will bless your heart. I bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. And it really is all about Him. Amen? It really is. He says, Lord, I'm sorry for the things that I've made it. Because it really is all about Jesus. And if we'll start celebrating His presence, He'll do the incredible. He'll show up. If we'll praise His presence, He'll perform in power. He'll show up. He'll do incredible things. And you ain't seen nothing yet. If you'll just worship the Lord and allow Him to move in your life, He'll do things that you've never seen before in our midst. The second thing we've got to do is our work should demonstrate His power. Our work should demonstrate His power. Jesus first called His disciples. We read about it in Matthew chapter 10. The Bible says He gave them power over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of diseases. They go out, they're all excited because, you know, they're able to do these miracles. They come back and they're all excited. Even the demons so are subject to us. And Jesus says, don't get excited over that. Get excited because your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Get excited because you're saved, not because you can work miracles. And there's something to be said in that. But you fast forward, that was at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. You fast forward about 3.5 years. At the end of Jesus' ministry, the night before He is betrayed and He's getting taken and beaten and crucified and hung on the cross, He's in the upper room with His disciples. And He tells them in John chapter 14, verse number 12, He says this. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. This is what Jesus is saying. You ain't seen nothing yet. You think what I did was great. You ain't seen nothing yet. That's what He says. And we think, man, that's crazy. Because Jesus did all kinds of miracles. Jesus did all kinds of great works. And we're going to do something greater than that. Well, not maybe greater in magnitude, but greater in multitude. See, not greater in magnitude, because Jesus did things that no one else can do. And we couldn't do it today if it wasn't for the touch of the Lord in our lives, right? We're not the one that heals blind eyes and that raises the dead and that makes the lame to walk. And we can't do that, but God can do it through us, right? It's through His power. But what He's saying is it's not going to be so much in magnitude as it is in multitude, because He's saying your works are going to be more far-reaching than any works that He did. All of Jesus' ministry happened, well, about 35 miles from His house, and that's it. That's as far as he was able to reach. You can reach more people in one day than Jesus did in His entire lifetime. With Facebook and some of these other social media things, Instagram and Snapchat and all this other stuff. I don't even know what it is or what it's called or what it looks like. But you can reach people that He could never reach, far more reaching than He could. See, if you look through the book of Acts, that's when it all kind of started, right? That's the Acts of the Apostles. This is what they did after Jesus died and rose again and ascended into heaven. This is what they did. And you look through the books of Acts, you see a few miracles. They do have a few miracles, but mostly what you see is massive conversions. People by the thousands are getting saved. Peter goes out and preaches after the day of Pentecost, and more people get saved on that day than through all of Jesus' ministry for the last 3.5 years, because Jesus says, you're going to do greater works than what I've done. He's saying you've not seen anything yet, not greater in scope, but greater in scope, not greater in sort. Jesus would explain that when he is ascended up into heaven, he would send the Holy Spirit. And see, I still believe in the miracle working power of Jesus. I believe Jesus can still do things that no one else can do. I still believe that he can touch. See, I don't have the power to save. I don't have the power to heal. I don't have the power to deliver. I don't have the power to set free. I don't have the power to do any of that. But I can introduce you to the man who has the power to turn your circumstances around. I can introduce you to the man who has the power to tear down your walls and to part waters for you and to walk through the fire with you. I can introduce you to somebody who still heals, who still mends, who still redeems, who still sets free, who still removes sins from your life. I can introduce you to Jesus, and he's still a Savior. Amen? Hallelujah. Our ministry should demonstrate his power, and we have to allow his power to work in our lives. I thought about this back during Vacation Bible School. You know, it's been, a month ago now, it seems like. It doesn't seem like it's been that long, but it has. And we had all of these decorations. And one of my jobs was not to hang posters, because they probably knew I'd hang them crooked or upside down or something. My job was not to do much decorating, but I did have to blow up balloons. And I thought, man, I've got like 500 balloons here. I can't blow all them up. It'll bust my eardrums, and you know how you blow it. So I got an air compressor. Air compressor works a lot better than I do, right? Could you imagine you have a flat tire and you go out and you unscrew the little valve, the little thing on the valve stem, and you get down on it and you start blowing on it? That would be funny. I did see something the other day. I don't know, somebody sent me a little video. This woman gets out of this car, and she's got a flat, and she gets a bicycle pump, and she puts it on her tire, and she's out there trying to pump up her tire with it. I thought that was funny. Why are you trying to do things within your own power when you can hook our compressor up and boom, a tire's inflated just like that, right? It's kind of the same way in our lives. Why are we trying to do things in our own power? We can't do anything, but we can allow God to do things in us and through us. And see, if you allow God to work in you, then God can work through you. But he first has to work in you so that he can work through you. See, I'm not the giant slayer. Jesus is the giant slayer. All I do is walk in the victory of what he's already done. And what amazing things he can do in our lives if we'll just let him work in us. See, he works in me so that he can work through me. We think that we want God to do something great in our lives. God work in me. That's great. But he works in you so that he can work through you, so that he can demonstrate his power to other people, so that he can touch lives. He uses us to demonstrate his power. Our work should demonstrate his power. And if we would do that, then we haven't seen the limits of what God can do. You ain't seen nothing yet if you allow God to work in your life. And finally, somebody say amen. Praise the Lord. We're getting ready to eat. Hurry up, brother. I got a birthday cake somewhere over there. I don't know if it's really a birthday cake, but it is my birthday. Happy birthday, Jeff. So it's his birthday too. Our word should articulate his promise. Our word should articulate his promise. Our worship should celebrate his presence. Our work should demonstrate his power. And our word should articulate his promise. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse number 9 says this. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. This is often quoted as a reference to the unknown mysteries of heaven. That heaven is so grand that eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard. It's never entered into the heart of men the things that God has prepared for them. Basically, what that verse is saying is you ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen anything yet like heaven has. And it's true. Heaven is better than we could ever imagine. And we should talk more about heaven. I believe that if we would talk more about heaven, there'd be more folks that wanted to go. I believe if we talk more, if we articulated heaven a little bit better, people would want to go to heaven a little bit more. But we can't articulate something that we're not acquainted with. You have to first be acquainted with it before you can articulate it. You have to know it before you can tell it. And this is what Scripture says about Jesus and about us going to heaven. I used this in a funeral just this past week at my aunt's funeral. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 4, "Beloved, I have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For we say unto you by the word of the Lord that we who are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them who are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." I'm here to tell you, Jesus is coming back to take us to heaven. Hallelujah. "And eye hasn't seen, nor ear heard, nor entered into the heart the things that God has prepared for them." That he has prepared for them. Revelation says this in Revelation 21, beginning with verse 4. "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." Listen, we're going to a place that Jesus has prepared for us that's going to be perfect. It's going to be glorious. The Revelation talks about streets of gold and walls of jasper and gates of pearl and how wonderful it's going to be, a crystal sea. I think we need to know more about heaven before we can talk about heaven. "Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor either entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared." And Jesus told his disciples, John chapter 14, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it was not so, I would have told you." But he says, "I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you shall be also." What's going to make heaven glorious is Jesus. He's going to make heaven glorious. That's who I want to see. We should be talking about. We should be articulating the promise of heaven. But let me burst your bubble here a little bit. That's not what the Scripture's talking about here. We use that Scripture all the time. Eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Yes, that is talking about heaven. But in the context of what Paul is writing, Paul is referring to the wisdom of God. And he's saying real wisdom comes from God. And any revelation that we have is not nothing that come on our own. It owes nothing to human wisdom. It's all about God's wisdom. Paul is reliant on God's wisdom. And he goes on in that scriptures and he says this: "But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knows no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received, not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God." We should be talking about the promise of heaven, but we also should be talking about the promise of his Holy Spirit. And you've not seen anything yet if you would just articulate the promise of God's word, which says that he's going to send us another comforter. Jesus told his disciples, "You shall receive power once the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You will receive power. I don't know about you, but I'd like to have some power because I'm weak and I need his power in my life. Jesus told his disciples in John 14, verse 16, he says, "And I will pray the Father, and he will send you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." He goes on, he says, "But the comforter, who is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." See, being saved is great. It's the greatest miracle that will ever take place is somebody getting saved. The greatest thing that ever happened in your life is you give your life to Jesus. The greatest thing. But if you'd get filled with the power of his promise, if you allow the Holy Spirit to come into your life, you ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't even begin living. When you get saved, that's just the start. God wants to do so much more in your life, and our words should articulate his promise. We need to be telling people about the promise of the Holy Spirit that Jesus can give to those who believe in him. Listen, I believe in my spirit that although we've seen God move, he ain't done yet. Although we've seen God do miraculous things, you ain't seen nothing yet. Although we've seen him do wondrous works in our lives, the best is yet to come. But we've got to do some things on our part. We've got to worship. We've got to work. We've got to spread the word like never before. We've got to tell God how much we love him through our worship. We've got to show God how much we love him through our work. We've got to tell others how much God can be in their lives through our words. We've got to tell people about Jesus. Amen? And if we'll do that, if we'll worship, if we'll work, and if we'll spread his word, he'll do great and miraculous things in our lives. Do you believe that today? Give him some praise.